Now, you know, when we talk of a method, sources which are used for tea. And there are three sources. Experience, reason, and individual. Pratyaksha, perception. Pratyaksha, that is perception.
Now it is because of this perception and verification
7, Kautilya is talking about. The Kayatha was the spoon rebel. And what we find is, later in the 17th century, in the Western tradition, Locke, Bhakti, Hume, the empiricist thinkers, putting forward a philosophy based on perception and verification. And again in the 19th century, Vienna Circle, and scientists working in Vienna Circle, and logical positivists like Professor A.J. Ayer, all of them, they were strong supporters of this empirical school, because one reason was the tremendous progress made by science and technology, and transformation brought by science and technology into the living situations of human persons. There, what we find is that the difference, Lokayata also are empiricists, and logical positivists also are empiricists. And Lokayatas as well as the logical positivists, they thought that this is the exclusive source of knowledge which will give us direct thinking and judgment. So the exclusive position is not really taken by Chanakya or Kautilya, but Lokayatas took this exclusive position. 19th century logical positivists took this exclusive position, that perception and perception alone. And therefore what I said, there is one word, pratyaksham eva. Eva means only. Perception alone is the source of valid knowledge. So this methodology is the empirical methodology. It's very essential. Because for a leader, and especially a ruler, when has to rule and has to take decisions pertaining to activities here on this earth, this life situation, he has to, or he or she has to take the recourse to empirical methodology. Pakistan hamla kar raha hai. Judge kaise karenge? Empirically karenge, ki spiritually karenge, intuitively karenge, rationally karenge? Of course, the first source will be empirical. So, empirical source is very essential for a ruler. Now, later on, you already have completed Vidya Samudesha. Vidya Samudesha consists of Anvikshiki. Anvikshiki consists of Lokayata Samhya Yoga. And then Vidya Samudesha consists of what? Three other types. Apart from Anvikshiki. It consists of Trai, Vartha, Dandaniti. Now of Trai, Vartha and Dandaniti, Sankhya and Yoga, they are for Trai. Because they are a combination of reason and intuition. And Lokayata is for Vartha, but some part of Dandaniti also belongs to reason and intuition. Not entire Dandaniti can, but that I'll come to little later. Vartha, what do we mean by Vartha? Agriculture. Agriculture. Right? Right? Agriculture or Vartha means what? Vartha is agriculture. No, Vartha is not Vartala. Vartha is not that Vartha. Vartha is not that discussion. You know, a king should know something about the methodology of thought. Then he should also know how to make his kingdom prosperous. So he should know something about Vartha. It means it includes agriculture, trade, commerce, industry. Entire thing which is related to artha. Entire thing related to, yes, krushi goraksha vanijya. Krushi goraksha vanijya. Vartha includes also goraksha trade, commerce, industry. And Goraksha, cattle breeding. Go means not just cow, but it includes entire thing which comes under this as Goraksha. Mainly cattle breeding under that is cow, because cow is a very useful animal. And useful animal in the sense that every part which is connected with the body of cow is useful for Vartha, agriculture. You go to a farmer and just have chat with the farmer, and the farmer will tell you how cow is useful than buffalo. Every part of cow, the cow dung, cow urine, and also the skin of the cow and the milk and the progeny, you know, the bullock. Of course, the bullock is required for agriculture. When it was a society where technology was not advanced, but still, the vidyas which a king has to learn, a would-be king has to learn, not only the thinking process, but the implementation of the thinking process, and that vata, that is agriculture. And in gathering the knowledge of agriculture, more than reason and more than intuition, of course reason is required, but what is required is perception, pratyaksha. You know, if one wants mango fruits, then naturally the seed of mango is to be sown, then only the mango fruits will be there. So that way perception for that is useful for this. So actually what Chanakya is saying is that in certain domains like material wealth, or material prosperity, what is required is empirical foundation. And it's no wonder that till almost 7th century, India was an advanced country making progress in astronomy, astrophysics, mathematics, medicine, surgery. And all these are sciences which has a foundation in perception and verification. But perception alone, if it is, can you read it out?
Perception and verification.
Perception and verification. You have to verify the observations which are gathered, data which is gathered. And of course, mathematics. Mathematics is a very advanced type of knowledge based on empirical data, but it is experience and reason together, where formal mathematics makes further help for going at the micro level of the sciences. So formulation, the cryptic formulation of mathematical language, which is started from perception verification, but the language is developed with the help of reason. And that is why after 19th century, the logical positivists couldn't maintain that rigor, that perception alone. Now what happens with perception alone? Let us see the consequences. You said they were materialists, lokayatas. Somebody said atheists. Then somebody, all these are the result, are the consequences of this as the method of thinking. You know, perception. So, can God be perceived? God cannot be perceived. Even in laboratories, God cannot be perceived. You know, there may be microns, or there may be things which could be observed with the help of scientific equipments, but God is not such. Rebirth?
In atom now we say not God particle, the smallest.
But God particle may be alright, but God, the way we think of God, maybe divinity or maybe Saguna Sakar, are we able to perceive it? I'm saying perception. Experience is later. Experience has all indirect proofs. I'm coming to that. The rebirth, God, karma. All these were the postulates of Indian philosophy, of the schools which accepted reason and intuition as its source. Charvakas challenged it and said, we are not able to perceive rebirth, so no rebirth.
There are cases where rebirth has been authenticated, like xenoglossy. Children which were not exposed to a language speak their language in childhood.
But you know, there are attempts made by parapsychologists to establish phenomenon of rebirth. For the believers, it's very easy to accept it. The problem is, when we confine to a rigor of logic, it becomes very difficult to deny rejection of rebirth. Psychologically, we may need it. The point is there a room to accept it with logical rigor of argumentation, with perception alone as the source? And even reason, Anumana has a firm foundation of perception. Inference is based on perception. Inference cannot exist in vacuum. Get the point? So even rationally, to establish and to prove anything which is beyond perception, anything which is beyond verification, is difficult. That can be proved or established by intuition and only through indirect verification. For a moment you accept or you keep it in mind, later on I'll come to it. Let me first finish Lokayata. So Lokayatas rejected all that. They rejected rebirth, they rejected God, they rejected law of karma. They went to the extent saying that there is nothing like Purusharthas called dharma and moksha. So they rejected dharma. Now this is exactly what we come across when, let me see, 19th century logical positivists. A.J. Ayer, for example, the question was the meaning of language. The sentence, and you will be surprised, this table is made up of wood. Is it a meaningful sentence?
Yes.
Made up of wood. So of course, some metal also is used, but wood also is there. Or a sentence, this wall is having a particular color. Or a sentence, a lady is 5'1" tall. All these are meaningful sentences according to logical positivists because they are verifiable. But a sentence, it's a good table. It's a good table. Or a sentence, a lady who is 5'1" is virtuous lady, or pious lady, or ethically having good conduct. What is the verification for this? Is there a verification? For all sentences which lead or which deal with values, virtues, emotions, exclamations, all utterances which are other than information were considered as redundant, considered as false, considered as meaningless. And therefore A.J. Ayer, in his very famous book in 1936, wrote that all value judgments like X is good and X is beautiful are like abracadabra. Abracadabrak means it doesn't make any sense. You put some stones in a box and then you make a noise. It doesn't have any meaning. So similar is all these sentences. Now this was very shocking. This was very shocking for the 19th century thinkers, because 19th century thinkers of Western world had their roots in the Greek philosophy of Socrates and Plato and Aristotle. All of them, they spoke in high terms about ethics, virtues, values. Same thing happened in India much earlier. When Charvaka said that all this and beyond that, even scriptures, Shabda, Trai, what is Trai? Scriptures, Shabda. This also is nonsense. This also is nonsense because that doesn't have a verification. Trayo Vedasya Kartaraha Bhanda Dhurta Nishacharaha. It means the composers of the Vedas are Bhanda Dhurta Nishachara. It means they are foolish, they are hypocrites, and they are having the nightmares. Why? Because they are misleading the people, because they are not following perception as the source of knowledge. Look at that time, Charvakas had written this. Now, there is an advantageous position of perception alone. It is pro-science, pro-technology. And there is a disadvantageous position that it dismisses virtues completely. Ethical virtues? No ethical virtues. Utility is the biggest virtue. And hedonism. Hedonism is the greatest thing. So, and this was exactly what I'm trying to tell you is, once you follow a particular methodology, whether you are a thinker from this region or that region or that region or that region, your conclusions will be more or less same. Whether you are thinking in the 3rd century or whether you are thinking in the 19th century, if you are confining to perception alone, now it has its demerits also. Many demerits. Many demerits. Say for example, he may be knowing it, being a legal advisor. A trial is going on in the court of law. And the evidence is. But the judge is, whether the judge has the freedom to read between the lines, whether the lawyer has the freedom to read between the lines, and of course he has the freedom, he or she. But he or she has to give evidences for that reading between the lines. Otherwise everything is decided by evidences. And ultimately the decision maker is the judge. If the decision maker is like a logical positivist, who would say, I will go only by evidence, whether really the justice would be there or not. Because it is something which is knowledge, which is verifiable. But how about the wisdom? And wisdom, whether is that wisdom verifiable? That is the point. You go to any modern hospital, and especially they say in America, and the American doctors will completely follow the procedure which is written down. They will not go here, there, because they are more worried about the legal threats. So even though the doctor is able to see it, the doctor says, "Jo hona hai ho gaya hai, main kyun kar sakta." You know, we read many a stories of Birbal, and especially when Akbar is in difficulties and is not able to make a decision, Birbal with his wisdom is suggesting some way out in a very innovative way. That innovative way is something which is beyond perception and verification. So, there is the empirical method. But the empirical method is very essential for a king to follow, for a ruler to follow. Whenever it is Varta, whenever it is economic growth, whenever it is commerce, trade, industry, and also agriculture, and also dandaniti, that is rule making and implementing the rule and implementing the punishment when the rules are violated. It has to be the empirical approach. It cannot be other than empirical approach. But here also, sheer empirical approach is not adequate. Reason is to be used along with it. And therefore, Kautilya says, Lokayata, yes, is very essential part. Lokayatas are very, very logical. They are very terse thinkers. And therefore, Lokayatas are, we get the references of Lokayata philosophy and Lokayata scholars in Mahabharata, for example. And Draupadi is narrating in Vanaparva how many vidyas she had learned in the royal court of Drupada. And she says that there she had learned Barhaspatya. Barhaspatya, it means a knowledge which is very useful for a leader to create wealth, that is artha, and also dharma in the sense dandaniti. Dandaniti was always considered as something part of dharma, but separate from dharma, because this is directly punishable under the authority of a leader. Whereas dharma was not directly punishable under the authority of the leader. It was about dandaniti. So, for praja sukha, because what is the motto? Praja sukhe sukham raja. So for praja sukha, for the total well-being of the people, what is required? Dharma, artha and kama. That is creation of wealth, regulation of creation of wealth and satisfaction of desires. Wealth is the means for satisfaction of desires, that is artha, and therefore varta, goraksha, vanijja, all that is necessary. And danda is necessary because regulating creation of wealth. It means the material wealth, the material affluence, that is to be controlled and regulated, well controlled and regulated by appropriate rules. You must have studied. Do you remember? How should the danda be held by the king? If it is 2 lakhs, if a Raja is not caring about implementing it properly, chalo jo hota hai hone do, it is 2 lakhs, then there is an act. If it is too strict, then also people are restless. So the application of Danda Niti should be appropriate. Now for that appropriate application of Danda Niti, what is required is reason, anuman. Now here comes that vada. Or here comes that, not varta, but here comes that debate, argumentation. Anumana includes all, there are different types of anumanas, and there is a separate science developed in Indian tradition by Nyaya school. There are 16 variations of anumana and argumentation. I'm not going to tell you all those 16. What I'm only trying to tell you is that appropriateness of applying the dandaniti, appropriateness of approach towards material wealth is very, very important. Otherwise what happens? Either we come to a conclusion saying that material prosperity is bad, material prosperity is a hindrance, it should not be there, or we think that material prosperity is the only good thing.
He was talking about evidence which the leader has to inspect before taking a decision. But sometimes all evidence is not possible. It is said that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Right? But you are not able to get all the evidences. In that case, how can the leader take a decision?
That is why I said that reason is to be used.
Reason.
That is how he has to consult his ministers. A leader doesn't take that decision in isolation. Chanakya model.
That means that is where the perception and verification method does not work.
Alone.
My
whole emphasis is on exclusive use of perception and verification. What is required is reason also. Once reason comes in the picture, virtues come. When we say reason, the ethical virtues, the spiritual virtues, the aesthetic virtues, all the virtues they come. And even 20th century Western philosophers, they had to accept this, that no human culture or no human civilization can make progress unless and until we accept that virtues are important. And virtues also have their own logic. We don't require any logic for virtues. But if at all someone feels that virtue also has some logic, let them develop that logic. But Indian thought process and Sankhya is a philosophy which starts with empirical. You see, entire Prakriti and Sarga Prakriti, empirical. Everything under Prakriti, empirical. It's only one spiritual principle which is there, that is Purusha. A king doesn't have to think about Prakriti and Purusha, because whatever is in this universe is only a combination of Prakriti and Purusha. There is nothing like existing only Purusha or existing only Prakriti. You know, we are all combination of both consciousness and matter. Consciousness and matter. Now, how is it that reason comes in here? Here, reason comes in because the $100 question, or you may call a $1 million question, whatever it is. The question asked in this is, what is the goal of human life? Charvakas also asked this question, what is the goal of human life? And leader also is asking this question, what should I give to my people? And Charvakas say the only goal for human life is pleasure, sukha. Yavat jive, sukham jive. This is the motto. Very suitable to 21st century approach. Yavat jive, sukham jive. Arey yaar, main itna kama raha hu ya kama rahi hu? Kaun dekhega mera bhai, behan, chacha, chachi, saas, sasur? यहाँ तक कि मेरे माँ बाप को देखने के लिए भी रुक सकती है. जिंदगी में इतने कष्ट किए, अभी इतना कमा रहा हूँ, ये यावत जीवित सुखम जीवे. बट माइंड यू दैट दिस इज अ वेरी क्रूड फॉर्मुलेशन ऑफ सुखम. देयर ऑल्सो कैन बी अ वेरी लर्नेड फॉर्मुलेशन ऑफ सुखम. यावत जीवित सुखम जीवे. देयर इज नथिंग रॉन्ग इन सर्चिंग प्लेजर, सर्चिंग हैप्पीनेस. We all are motivated in search of pleasure and in search of happiness. Sankhyas also accept this. And they say that this entire activity of sarga and visarga is for getting rid of three types of dukkha. It means that we are also in search of some pleasure or some happiness. But that pleasure or happiness is not just the material pleasure or happiness. It is the material pleasure plus a value-based value. So, if you look at Vidya Samudesha, a king is to be trained in Rogayata with its strong points and its lacunas, so that king can create material wealth. King can encourage people to create material wealth. And we were quite affluent a nation till almost 7th, 12th century, or even till 14th century. How many times Somnath was looted? And why was Somnath looted? Because there was wealth. Because gold and diamonds and all other type of wealth, and that was taken to some other part. Why was India invaded so many times? Because it was a very wealthy country. Material wealth was there. You know, if you get time and if you happen to read something on ancient Indian history and culture, and if you read accounts of any book on ancient Indian history culture, accounts of foreign travelers visiting India, maybe Chinese travelers, or maybe later on the Dutch, the French, the Portuguese, and their records, and you will find two things invariably mentioned. One thing is the wealth of India and the virtuous approach of Indian people. Indian people are honest, virtuous, not now. Of 7th century, 5th century, 10th century. They don't rock their houses. They believe that the other person is honest. They keep the promises and they believe that the other persons will also keep promises. And apart from honesty and wealth and all this, they are extremely helpful. This will you find this all this you will find in the records. Which means we knew the importance of creating wealth. We knew the importance of enjoying wealth. That is why in the four Purusharthas, Artha and Kama are two Purusharthas. Otherwise, all the time people would have talked about moksha, 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 moksha. Kautilya is saying that in the Vidya Samudesha, the learning actually may begin with Lokayata. And you know, even nowadays, if you refer to any philosophical text, it begins with Lokayata. And then it rejects Lokayata's certain tenets. And then it establishes either the position of reason or the position of intuition. So the material wealth is created. And also law is established. Now creating mindset of the people is very essential. To protect the wealth, to enjoy the wealth, to distribute the wealth. There should be the mindset of the people cooperating each other rather than quarreling with each other, rather than snatching each other's wealth. It should be a collaborative effort rather than individualistic. And we were, how were we as a society? Remember my very first lecture? We were and what was the word for that? Yuki's ethnicity?
Dharma.
So people should be aware of Praja Dharma. And the leader should be aware of Raja Dharma. It means that there should be a code of conduct. It means that there should be reason. It means that there should be a dialogue. And it means that, so what is the meaning of Sankhya? Sankhya, number. Charcha, discussion. Vicharana, recommendation, description. Appreciation. Paramarsha, advice. That is Sankhya. So what does it advise? It advises what is the ultimate goal of life. Why is it that we are born as human persons on this earth? We are born on this earth to enjoy four purusharthas. Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. And mind you, Moksha came later. Initially it was only three. Dharma, Artha and Kama. You follow the virtuous life and Moksha is taken care of. Yes?
Where is the origin of the purusharthas? In which text it comes from?
Purusharthas you will find in Vedic literature, in Upanishads, in Brahmanas. And sometimes in some samhitas, but it's
the same. Sankhya and yoga.
No.
It's not in Patanjali yoga. And it's not in the Sankhya.
No. Sankhya is a school. What I am saying is that Sankhya and yoga, they are representing the entire approach of Vedas and Upanishads. In Chanakya. In Vidya Samuddesha. Don't take it as a general statement. Because later on came Vedanta. But as it is also, because they are based on Vedas and Upanishads as their sanction. So, here Lokayatas are absolutely non-binding. They denounce Vedas as hypocrites. And they are the supporters of Vedas and Upanishads. So it's a training for a king to know both the sides, the opposite side also, or rather the side which will criticize and the side which will support, and then the king has to take a decision. But the king was not allowed therefore to kill the either of the opposites. If the king supports the Lokayata position, then the king is not permitted to kill the Vaidics. Or the king is the supporter of the Vedic style and therefore he is supposed to kill the Charvakas. That's not the case. My point is, a leader is to train in the empirical method. Now you follow the empirical method and you will come across the result all over the globe. Empiricists will give the same result. Reason, automatically virtues come in. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, all of them, they were supporters of reason. They never very openly talked about intuition. Plato sometimes indirectly hints at intuition. But the concept of reason is very wide, which takes care of virtuous life. And you know, virtues are of three types. Moral virtues, aesthetic virtues. When I say, oh, the view is sublime, aesthetic virtue. And spiritual virtues. Person is a tranquil sage, spiritual virtue. And all the three categories, they are referred to in the writings of Greek thinkers. Even though they said that it is reason. Now, why is it that yoga is also included separately? Because yoga gives a modus operandi. Yoga gives a methodology. This is the praxis. What is the praxis? It brings transformation. It's not a simple practice. It's a practice which makes transformation possible. So it's a praxis. And yoga is that praxis. It brings transformation. So now you will understand why we have included yoga in our syllabus. Kautilya includes yoga in the syllabus of the prince. Believe. I've already told you that we require a very healthy life, a very normal life, and energetic life, utsaha shakti, and also mantra shakti. Meditation of yoga consists of mantra shakti. But we all, in the present pattern of education, will not be able to say much about mantra shakti, because neither I know about it nor you know. You know, you said about the experiential part. Experiential part refers to quite a lot of capabilities of individual who is to experience that. And all the spiritual transformation which the praxis shows, person should have that capability to experience that transformation. Unless and until person has that capability, the person is not able to even communicate to a person who doesn't have that capability. That's a problem. You know, we all can see with our eyes that this table is made of wood, and therefore it is very easy for us to agree that it is made. But in case of mantra shakti, if we are not capable of those powers, we can equally be suspicious about those powers. You get the point? And therefore, logically, it becomes very difficult to refute Lokayatas. But that is. Now, this yoga, any question? Any difficulty? Anything which you would like to say? And then yoga, that is a praxis. Kautilya refers only to this, where he says pratyahara, dhyana and dharana. pratyahara, dhyana and dharana. It doesn't mention samadhi. Pratyahara, dhyana, dharana and dhyana. Samadhi. Samadhi is the last part, but it doesn't mention samadhi. A leader cannot go into samadhi. बैठा है राजा दरबार में, बैठा बैठा अगर समाधि में चला गया तो क्या होगा? नहीं चलेगा. यस, लीडर हैज टू बी अटेंटिव. कॉर्पोरेट हाउस में मीटिंग चल रही है, डायरेक्टर्स बैठे हैं, सीईओ बैठे हैं. सीईओ कहते हैं अरे क्या करूँ, समाधि लगा. डायरेक्टर्स विल नॉट बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड किस तरह की समाधि लग रही. So, person has to be very attentive. There is very beautiful word in Sanskrit language. Ashtavadhani. Avadhana, that is attention. Ashta, eight types. Simultaneously, a person giving attention to eight different things going on. And later on, when you will read Kautilya's Arthashastra, the daily routine of a king, you will realize that each time slot of 1.5 hours, a king is supposed to do multiple activities in that 1.5 hour. Multiple activities.
Ashtavadhani also means he has to be attentive in eight directions.
Multiple. Ashta simply. Ashta actually covers the entire space. Only the upper and the lower is not covered. But all other directions are covered and therefore ashta. So all directions are covered, it means that multiple attention. Don't take it literally. That would be like lokayata. Read between the lines, that is very important. And that is called vyanjana. You know, that is called vyanya artha. We always take it. Apan mhanto na, are to kaya shana chale baba. शहाणाच आहे असं म्हणत असताना आपण ज्या पद्धतीने शहाणा म्हणतो तसं आहे. पॉइंट इज मल्टी डायमेन्शन. नाउ व्हेन पर्सन हॅज ऑलरेडी डेव्हलप्ड यम नियम आसन प्राणायाम प्रत्याहार. चाणक्य मेन्शन्स, चाणक्य स्टार्ट्स फ्रॉम प्रत्याहार. द कॉमेंट्री इफ यू रीड, द कॉमेंट्री बिगिन्स फ्रॉम प्रत्याहार. And then dharana dhyana. So pratyahara, it means all the earlier aspects of bahiranga yoga are covered. And it is supposed that all earlier bahirangas the leader is expert in. Now there is a problem. What are the yamas? Ahimsa, satya, asteya, aparigraha, brahmacharya. Is a leader supposed to follow it? At verbatim, ahimsa. And suppose the country is invaded. Modi sahab ahimsa practice kar rahe. Country is invaded. And of course the final war to kiski lagti hai? BM ki lagti hai. To kya hoga? So a king has to use his discriminative knowledge, and that is reason, sankhya, charcha, vicharana, samkhya. Samkhya is a discriminative knowledge. It's a discrimination between viveka and aviveka, right and wrong, appropriate and inappropriate. And all these things cannot be decided in vacuum. Right, wrong, appropriate, inappropriate. Everything has a contextual reference. Hai na? Kisi ne 10 baar attack kiya. 10 baar reply kuch bhi nahi diya. 11th baar jo reply diya. In a context, whether that reply was appropriate or inappropriate. That is Sankhya. Sankhya doesn't simply mean Prakriti and Purusha. Sankhya means to discriminate between the spiritual and the material. Material is this worldly. And spiritual is this worldly, but it's at the elevated stage. It's not otherworldly. दूसरे जग में क्या होता है किसी ने देखा है? यहाँ एक अटैक हो गया, सारे मर गए, फिर कल्याण किसका करेंगे? सो एवरीथिंग, इवन व्हेन आई से इट इज अदर देन मटीरियल, इट इज टू बी अंडरस्टूड इन अ कंटेक्स्ट दैट दैट अदर वर्ल्डली एस्पेक्ट आल्सो इज रिलेटेड विद अवर ओन लिविंग. Now there are certain norms which are laid down which are not agreeable to charvakas, the lokas, like law of karma, like law of rebirth, that I am not going to speak about. Because Kautilya doesn't give a detailed explanation of these philosophical schools. He only highlights the important points of these schools. When I read it first time, I thought, why is it that he is including these philosophical schools in a training of a prince? Second time, third time, and then when I looked at it as a method, then I realized, because you see the leaders in India, especially of ancient India, the goal which was advocated for the leaders was always that a leader should be enlightened one, not only knowledgeable, knowledge, wisdom and spirituality, knowledge, wisdom and beyond. You know, in 2013 there was an international seminar on this in Beijing with reference to future of human culture and civilization, knowledge, wisdom and beyond. Knowledge, wisdom and beyond. And when it was suggested that this already had been in India, because the enlightened leader, the concept of Rajarshi, which you will do in the next term, is based on all this. Rajarshi, the training of a Rajarshi is a training of Lokayata, is a training of Sankhya, is training of Yoga. A leader is, and I had mentioned it in my second lecture if you remember, a leader is supposed to do yogic exercises every morning, early morning, and the entire day what the leader will be eating. And what will be the treatment for the leader for good health would be decided by a Vishakvarya, that is a person who is doctor, medical person, and a dietitian.
Ahara
Vihara Vichara. Give it a name, and Ahara Vihara Vichara. The entire activity, and that is Sankhya Yoga. That is Sankhya Yoga, and it is this praxis, where this enlightenment, which brings complete transformation in the life of the king, the leader. And there are ample examples of enlightened leaders. You read the life of Shri Krishna in Mahabharata. Read original Mahabharata. Because translation in every Indian language is available. Whichever language you use, Hindi mein, Gujarati mein, you point the language and the translation is. And look at the life of Krishna, Shri Krishna. And the word Shri, which is used as a suffix before, Rama, Shri Rama. Shri again is a significant upasarga, suffix of Ashta Aishwaryas, eight type of different wealth. I'm not going to enumerate. read that, the whole account and how the decisions are taken. And as I say, contextuality is important. Even though Krishna has taken a vow that I will not hold any weapon in the war, two times he violates. First time he picks up the wheel of a chariot and then runs to Bhishma, and Bhishma keeps the weapon down. And second time, when it is Jayadratha, he holds his Sudarshan. Contextual. He never said, I have taken a vow and therefore what may happen, I will stick to my vow. Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya tulskrutam dharma samasthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge. So the motto of a leader should be paritranaya sadhunam. It means encouragement and protection to virtuous people. Vinashaya tulskrutam, the wicked, the cunning, the looters, the plunderers, the killers, they should be punished. They should be punished. It's a responsibility of a leader. Then only dharma will be established. Sambhavami yuge yuge. This will be true, universal truth. This will hold good for era after era. If a leader is like this, criminalization of politics, where will be the protection of the virtues? And protection to the killers, where will be the possibility of restoration of dharma? Who are people can contest elections even though they are in jail, and against them there are charges and charges and charges. Not only that, they contest election but they win the election. Then they are accommodated as the minister either of the cabinet level or at the state level. A person in the jail is not eligible to vote, but a person in the jail is eligible to contest the election. किसी ने तो सोचना चाहिए ना कि ये क्या संभव आमी युगे युगे का. Enlightened leadership is like this. Enlightened leadership is the leadership of Krishna. Another enlightened leadership is.
अपन कंडीशनल हो जो.
कसर.
जेल मध्ये जाणारा प्रत्येक खऱ्या गुन्ह्यात गेला की गुन्हा सिद्ध झाला त्याच्यावरती अवलंबून आहे.
तुमच्यावरती 19 गुन्हे दाखल आहे, एक नाही दोन नाही 25 गुन्हे दाखल आहे.
गुन्हा दाखल होणं आणि गुन्हा सिद्ध होणं याच्यामध्ये फरक असतो.
यु आर अंडर ट्रायल. तुम्ही वोट का नाही करू शकत ना?
बरोबर.
सिटीजनला वोटिंगचा अधिकार नाही आहे. जो असाच तुरुंगात आहे ना, मला तुमचा मुद्दा कळ, जो असाच तुरुंगात आहे की ज्याला त्याच्यावरती आरोप सिद्ध नाही झाला, तो आहे 10 वर्ष तुरुंगात आहे. कारण ठरवलंच आहे की त्याला कुजवायचंच आहे, त्याला बाहेर काढायचंच आहे. त्याला वोटिंग करता येतं का? नाही करत. पण तो इलेक्शन कंटेस्ट नाही करू शकत. कंटेस्ट बळ नाही आहे, पैसा नाही आहे. अर्थ भीष्म म्हणतात महाभारतात, भीष्म सेज इन महाभारतात, अर्थस्य पुरुषो दासः, आय एम अ सर्वंट ऑफ द पॉलिटिकल पॉवर. अर्थ म्हणजे केवळ वेल्थ नाही, अर्थ इज नॉट ओनली वेल्थ, अर्थ मीन्स गव्हर्नन्स, अर्थ इज द पॉवर ऑफ गव्हर्नन्स. अर्थशास्त्र इट्स नॉट जस्ट द ट्रिटाइज ऑफ क्रिएशन ऑफ वेल्थ, इट्स अ इट्स अ ट्रिटाइज ऑफ गुड गव्हर्नन्स. अँड भीष्म सेज अर्थश्च पुरुषो दासः, आय एम अ स्लेव ऑफ दिस गव्हर्नन्स, आय एम एम्प्लॉई ऑफ दिस गव्हर्नमेंट. Therefore, I can't take any stand against the government. He's like a bureaucrat. Krishna said, I am not a servant of any governance whatsoever. Neither Dwaraka, nor Mathura, nor Indraprastha, nor Hastinapura. I'm a free person. But my motto is to protect. You will serve enlightened leaderships and you will find there are ample. You know, very recently there was those who, if at all you are watching color TV Marathi, and there was a serial called Awaz. Awaz, that is voice of history. 6 episodes were for Gyaneshwar, life of Gyaneshwar. Other 6 episodes, 6 or 10 episodes for Jyotiba Phule. And the last episodes were for Ahilya Bai Holkar. She was the enlightened leader. If any one of you can get it, we may screen those and we'll see how each decision of hers indicative of discrimination between right and wrong and appropriate and inappropriate. Shivaji, another enlightened leader. So there are enlightened leaders. Chanakya has laid down a foundation for that enlightened leadership. And it has not come from vacuum. Chanakya quotes so many others. You must have listened. Kon kon hai? Kaunapadatta hai, Pishuna hai, ani kon hai? All these are the commentators who have created some text or other on Arthashastra. Even when Anvikshiki and Traivartha, Dandaniti, all these are calculated. So, Kautilya mentions opinions of others and says that, well, I am here to hold a position that the entire syllabus must focus on 4 main aspects. Others may vary on. My point is that there were other traditions also. So in the second term, when we discuss about enlightened leadership, you will have this as a backdrop. Enlightened leader is already trained in this way. Yoga, it means a very disciplined way of life. Sankhya is the enlightened way of life. Yoga also is giving not only training for body and mind, but it's a training for body, mind and self. Sharir, manas and atman, body, mind and self or soul. And it is this that is learnt and learnt and learnt and practiced and practiced and practiced. And then king automatically practices. You know what is a character? Aristotle has once, he has written letters to his son. That has come into a book form, Eudaimonia. And in the letters to his son, he writes that character is that behavioral pattern which has become habitual. Of course, it's good, not the bad part. If it's a good part, it's a good character. Smoking, habit, part of a character. Galia, habit, part of a character. Virtuous practice, part of a character. That is habit. So it's a good character or a bad one. So the enlightened leader is a result of this syllabus, which of course is to be practiced by a student. So if you have any questions, welcome. Today I have not touched upon enlightened leaders topic except giving you some hints from the life of Sri Krishna. Only 5 minutes baki hai.
Regular. 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 Reg
So many books, so many treatises on enlightened leadership. Which would be the best from if you look at the comparative?
For example,
you said there are multiple treatises on.
No. You misunderstood my remark. I said Kautilya mentions all these. They are lost to us.
Oh.
I said different types of Arthashastra, the treatises, Kautilya mentions. But they have not come to us. And the examples, of course, are available to us. We can read the books. Like of Shivaji and Krishna and Ayyavai and so many others.
So how does one differentiate between leadership and enlightened leadership? When is that tipping point?
It's a very good question. But before I answer this question, I would like you to respond to this question. What will be your response? You know, how will you discriminate between? Why is it that the enlightened leadership is preferred to any other leadership which may not be enlightened? Yes.
What I understand is it has a positive impact on the human society at large.
Yes.
Enlightened leadership. And so once they follow the enlightened leader in mass, then it brings good to them also and long run also. And it is not only for that particular period, but it's for ages and centuries. That is what I understand.
Would an enlightened leadership have some spiritual angle to it?
Spiritual angle, yes. If we refer to Chanakya, yoga is the spiritual angle. But it doesn't mean that the leader has to practice rituals in public domain.
Correct.
That is not it. Chanakya never speaks of leader practicing rituals in public domain. Even though he says, as a part of his daily routine, the priest visits the king and king goes to the temple and all that. But you know, of the entire 24 hours schedule, if king is spending some 1 hour for these, then you understand that the line between the private and the public has to be maintained. But as it is, Kautilya never says that a leader therefore should propagate rituals in him. He makes a distinction between the rituals and virtues. And throughout he emphasizes virtues, but never the rituals. He never says rituals. And virtues and values are certainly different from rituals. Person may be absolutely ritualistic, but there is no guarantee that therefore the person is virtuous. Person may not be bound by rituals. Person will be virtuous. There is a difference. The point is, two criteria, according to me. No, the discrimination between the leader and the
enlightened.
Intuition, yes. But again, for the observer, what is the criteria to verify the intuition? There should be some manifestation of that intuition out there, which would be good. And that good would be good for all. That is one. And protection of virtue and elimination of vice, wickedness. That is another.
Protection of virtue and elimination.
Elimination of vice and wickedness.
Is that the truth which distinguishes between the enlightened and.
According to me, you are free to add to the list. But you know, leadership cannot be black and white. Leadership can be of colors. It's very, look at, for example, leadership of Ravana and leadership of Ram. There can be many, many ways that we can think about these two leaders. Ravana also was a leader of a very prosperous society. After all, it was a golden Ganga. He was learned, he was a scholar, he was a pundit. But Chanakya says, only one thing was against and that resulted into his destruction, and that was uncontrollable kama. He desired the wife of other person, he did not touch Sita, but still he abducted. And that act of abduction was considered as wickedness. Kautilya mentions it later on in Enlightened Leadership Sutras. You will come. But there the Patnaikas put it differently. You know, what he says is that every decision of Ravana is egocentric. मैं और मेरा, मैं और मेरा, मुझे चाहिए मतलब चाहिए. And every decision of Rama is duty centric. मैं वन में जाऊंगा because I am bound by duty towards my parents. This is how Devdutt Patnaik has discriminated. I'm putting these examples for you to think over. So there is no there is no No. What I want to say is not just one way of thinking. There are multiple ways where you can think about. I must be acceptable, agreeable, approachable, and supported by the masses. But this is egocentric. Why is it that I am seeking support of people? Because I should be a leader. अगले election में मुझे जीतना है. अगर अगले election में जीतना है, तो कुछ न कुछ बहाना करके मुझे लोगों का support चाहिए. चाहे कभी वो मंडल कमीशन हो, बाकी वहाँ जितना खून खराबा होता है वो मुझे कुछ पड़ी नहीं. Remember some quite a few years back in 80s, Mandal Commission was all of a sudden came out of the blue. And who was responsible for it? And what was the ulterior intention? It was not Praja Sukha. I should get elected, and not only I should get elected but my party, because then only I will be another time a prime minister. So a leader definitely tries to seek the support of people, his or her people. But enlightened leader many a times goes beyond.
Mandal Commission gave opportunities to people who were deprived of their money.
I'm talking about the intention of a leader.
Okay. That was the
I'm not talking about Mandal Commission's recommendations. I'm talking about the time when the Mandal Commission was introduced.
Political agenda.
Similarly, the Maratha Morchas. Look at the time span picked up. Now again some of you will rise and will say, but Marathas should be given reservation.
Debatable.
Marathas may be given reservation, but at the time when the elections are there, municipal corporations elections, and then Jilla Parishad's elections, and then the assembly election, and then of course the nation elections. And you all know uska karta karavita dhani bolavita kon hai. Leadership and enlightened leadership. आपण कसे विक्टिम बनतो ना ते लीडरशिपचे विक्टिम असतो. वी आर विक्टिमाइज्ड बाय ऑल दीज लीडरशिप इगोइस्टिक लीडरशिप. एनलाइटन लीडरशिप आपण फार बघितलीच नाही.
Enlightened leader is a benevolent leader.
I won't say benevolent, not all the time.
Reformative leader.
Contextually is he wants ultimately benevolence. And to establish benevolence at times he has to adopt certain stringent policies. Then with all courage, that leader will implement.
End result has to be there. That's the focus of enlightenment.
You know, not a very good example, but during the partition period, one of the Congress leaders was walking with the leader's daughter. And a victim of partition entered and just held the hand of the daughter. And the leader became aggressive. He left the hand. He said, "Sir ji, aapki beti ka haath hi to pakda hai. Hamari maa behno ka kya hua?" Kabhi socha? Enlightened leadership and material leadership. Lokancha krodh jo asto na, तो असा असतो आतमध्ये खटखट होतो, बट इट डझंट गेट द आउटलेट बिकॉज द लीडरशिप डझंट अलाव अँड द पीपल आर टिमिड. वी पीपल आर टिमिड बिकॉज वी आर नॉट ऑर्गनाइज्ड. वी आर नॉट ऑर्गनाइज्ड. एक मराठा लाख मराठा, वाय इज इट पॉवरफुल? बिकॉज ॲटलीस्ट दॅट पिरियड दे आर ऑर्गनाइज. But unfortunately, we cannot organize under the flag of benevolent leadership or flag of better or quality life. कुछ हमारे पढ़ने ही नहीं पड़ता, ज़्यादा ही नहीं है यहाँ. So you people have to think about it. You have to think about implementation. It may be a small implementation. I know you are not going to contest election in assembly. Neither in Jilla Parishad, don't contest elections. But you can act as a leader organizing people in the areas where you are working and ignite their minds for protection of virtue and elimination of. जिंदगी में कौन सी भी चीज आसान नहीं है. पैसा कमाना भी कहाँ आसान है, डिफिकल्टी है ना. प्रमोशन है, टारगेट कम्प्लीशन है, टीम के साथ एडजस्टमेंट है, एक्स्ट्रा वर्क है. हैप्पी मैरिड लाइफ में भी कहाँ आसानी कहाँ. My point is, only thing is that we have to think systematically, then act. Act in an organized way. आप लोग जो अपना ग्रुप बनाए हो ना, keep in touch with each other even after 5 years, 10 years. And people will add, because we are not going to close the course. There will be second batch, third batch, fourth batch. And there will be the power of aluminum. Each aluminum is like a powerful God pattern. And there will be the power. This is how Krishna operated. Think about it. Then in next term we'll discuss it directly.